host here on ITV1, and the Reds are over on ITV4. The Champions League live at 7:30 tonight.
Concert crush. Five teenage girls are injured as thousands turn out to see X Factor finalist JLS perform.
Ending the cash in hand culture that benefits tax evaders but costs the country £2 billion a year.
And spurring on, Ledley King scores for the first time in 3 years, retaining Harry Redknapp's unbeaten crown at Tottenham. That's what we're talking about on the News Hour today. It's Tuesday, the 9th of December, 2008.
Hello, good morning. You're watching the News Hour. It's 6 o'clock. Also this hour, we'll talk to the teenage girl stabbed 20 times and left for dead. This the day after her attacker was sent to prison.
Also coming up this hour, with most retailers facing an awful Christmas, we'll look at the pound stores beating the recession with bargain deals.
And we're live on the most festive street in Britain, where neighbours have clubbed together to bring a little light into each other's lives. A little light. A lot of light into each other's lives.
Rather a lot of light there. First, though, Andrea is lapping up the Christmas spirit in Kent for us this morning.
That's right, Priya. I'm in Lapland in Bulwater in Kent this morning. We're going to give you a little bit of a taste of Christmas, and there's lots more of this sort of thing to come. We've got Christmas trees. We're even going to do a little bit of ice skating with some rather handsome men. And I've done a recce, as they call it in television, and I think we're going to be all right. Let's have a look and see what the weather's got in store for today. This has been the wettest part of the country overnight here in Kent. The rain is just clearing away, so we should see some brighter skies later on. However, it is cold across many parts of the country. We will see a frosty start for many. We've got some showers across parts of Scotland, namely the northwest. For this afternoon, those showers will move to the northeast. We could well see one or two showers too filtering down from Yorkshire into East Anglia. But away from that, once this rain clears away, I think it's going to be cold, but not too bad. I'll give you more details in 20 minutes.
Andrea, thanks. Our top story this morning. Teenage fans of X Factor finalist JLS were caught in a terrifying crush last night when chaos broke out at a free concert. Four people were taken to hospital and more were treated at the venue in South London, where the boys were performing a surprise gig ahead of Saturday night's final. Aruge Defuicio was there.
They'd come for a night to remember, but for all the wrong reasons, it was a night they'd never forget. When 5,000 fans turned up for just 200 free tickets, the crowd surged, crushing some against the barrier.
Everyone just pushed and the barriers broke and the police just came out of nowhere and just tried to stop everyone.
People pushing against barriers, had to be bouncers, had to take the kids out and everything.
People getting punched in the face, people getting kicked, people on the floor, people just trodden all over them.
Five people were injured and four taken to hospital, one with a suspected fracture. JLS say they never expected to see so many fans.
I don't think everyone expected the numbers that have come down today, you know. Obviously, we've heard that things have happened, and, you know, obviously it's unfortunate, but, you know, we're here...
speedy recovery, of course.
But organisers claim they did everything to control the crowds.
You get crushes that happen in all sorts of walks of life. The mere fact that the audience, which is all young girls, pushed forward, so there's going to be a crush when you've got barriers in front. We've done our best, and we believe done it reasonably well, to cope with the current problem.
Before playing the gig, JLS said hello to fans who didn't get in, giving the police another small headache. This time, no one was hurt.
Aruge Defuicio reporting there.
Let's catch up on the rest of the news. Here's Tiffany.
Thank you. Good morning. A group of MPs is this morning calling for tougher action on tax evaders who work for cash in hand, costing the government an estimated £2 billion a year in unpaid tax revenues.
Have you paid a builder cash in hand? How about a cleaner or maybe a decorator? What's the harm in that? Well, £2 billion, says the government. It claims 2 million people in the UK aren't paying tax on the money they're earning, and it means the rest of us are paying more. The chances of being caught are slim. There's just a 1.5% chance of tax evaders being discovered, and the penalties are minimal. Revenue and customs officials are struggling to crack down on the culprits, and most of us don't realise they're doing anything wrong.
I have paid for our bathroom to be redone cash in hand.
we had a break-in at our house and we had a window replaced and we paid cash in hand for that.
Cash passes hands and it's up to them what they then declare, isn't it?
But today a group of MPs is saying tax evaders can't hide anymore. They're calling for the revenue and customs officials to start forcing workers to pay 100% of the tax they owe or face much more serious consequences.
Displaying cigarettes and tobacco products in shops is expected to be banned as part of a plan to cut down on the number of people who smoke. Instead, they'll be moved under the counter and out of sight in what's hoped will discourage children from taking up the habit and help those who've already quit. But critics are trying to block the plan, saying corner shops and newsagents could lose out. Three people have been confirmed dead after an American fighter jet crash-landed in San Diego. Two homes were destroyed when the plane came down just 2 miles from its base in California. The pilot, thought to be on a solo training exercise, safely ejected from the aircraft, but is thought to have sustained injuries. The government's economic rescue package seemed to have been given the public seal of approval this morning, with a new poll suggesting people trust Gordon Brown more than David Cameron when it comes to leading the country through recession. The populist poll shows Labour's rating on the economy has jumped 6 points since the pre-budget report, but the Conservatives still hold a 4-point overall lead. There's more bad news for retailers this morning, with November's sales figures showing a drop of 0.4% on last year. It's the second month in a row that like-for-like sales have dropped. The British Retail Consortium said the figures prove the high street's facing a nerve-wracking Christmas. The alleged mastermind of the 9/11 terrorist attacks and his four co-defendants have told a pre-trial hearing at Guantanamo Bay they intend to plead guilty. Khalid Sheikh Mohammed said they had decided to abandon efforts to defend themselves on the day Barack Obama was elected. It means they could now face execution. May be the stuff of old wives' tales, but it seems a nice hot drink really can help cure the common cold. Researchers at Cardiff University found sipping a hot mug of fruit cordial gave significant and sustained relief from cold and flu symptoms, like a runny nose, sore throat and tiredness. And on the website this morning, why the credit crunch is forcing many families to cut back on food this Christmas, how motorists would rather save a few pounds than save the environment. And we've an exclusive first look at the trailer for Disney's up-and-coming 3D animation adventure Bolt. All that and more at gm.tv. And finally, there's already talk of an Oscar nomination for Brad Pitt in his latest role. He was joined by Angelina Jolie and his co-star Kate Blanchett on the red carpet in Los Angeles for the premiere of the highly anticipated film The Curious Case of Benjamin Button. Carla Romano was there.
The sexiest man alive walking down the red carpet for the premiere of his latest movie, The Curious Case of Benjamin Button. With co-star Kate Blanchett and other stars like J-Lo exciting the crowds, there was only one woman stealing the limelight, and it was shining on Angelina Jolie, who also had the very important job of looking after Brad's parents, who came along for support. The movie centres around a man who is ageing in reverse, and it's one of the most hotly anticipated films of the year.
E7.
And we really took it more as two individuals who cross at different times, and at one point it makes sense for them to come together, but that must end too at some point.
The Curious Case of Benjamin Button isn't the only big movie this Christmas. Brad Pitt competes with ex-wife Jennifer Aniston's Marley and Me, which is also out on Christmas Day. Although it could be a day of the battle of the exes at the box office, at home Brad and Angelina will have more than enough to think about on Christmas Day. They're six children.
The time is now 6:08. Now it's back to John and Priya.
Thanks so much indeed. Let's take a look at the morning papers. The Independent leads on what they call the great credit card scandal. Companies defy ministers by increasing charges despite plunging interest rates. The Financial Times, pensions lifeboat risks being swamped. That's corporate schemes apparently in big, big trouble. May swamp the lifeboat scheme set up by the government. The Times, Brown's recovery gathers pace with new poll boost. That's a poll saying who's best to lead us out of the recession. Most people favour Alistair Darling and Gordon Brown ahead of David Cameron. And the front page of Daily Telegraph, jobless middle class get study cash. The £120 million scheme, I should say, it will help white-collar victims in the recession to return to university. And that's about it, apart from the news on the front page of The Guardian, which I shouldn't forget, of course, that apparently army supplies are having to go a very roundabout route through Belarus and Ukraine to get supplies to our lads and lasses in Afghanistan.
Quick look at the front of the tabloids, front of the Daily Mirror, ex-frack Lewis. This is the story told about in the news. There's several fans injured at a JLS gig. We're going to be talking to some relatives of JLS later on in the news hour. Front of the Daily Express, tank of petrol now £18 cheaper than it was in the summer. That's got to be good news, hasn't it? Front of the Daily Mail, home packs fiasco. The government are now going to insist that we have our home packs when we put our house on sale on that very day rather than 28 days later. And the front of the Sun, baby P victory at last. They say this is the dismissal of the head of children's services at Haringey Council, Mrs. Shoesmith, who has been sacked.
OK, time now, 6:10, time from sport. Harry Redknapp retained his unbroken record of wins for Tottenham last night as captain Ledley King headed in his first goal in 3 years to help Spurs beat West Ham 2-0. With that and all the other sports news, joined now by the Daily Star's Brian Woolnough. So, Harry does it again.
He does. Great record, isn't it? Basic management. He's a good manager, as we know, and he's lifted Spurs onto a new level. They're still around the bottom of the Premier League, so you can't relax, but his record since he joined there is fantastic.
Four league wins.
And the players are full of confidence. Yeah, only one defeat. So there's something about Redknapp that's infectious, yeah. And the players clearly are enjoying playing for him.
Sure, let's have a look at the action. You can just talk us
and through. Last night they were never really in danger, I didn't think. West Ham aren't a great side. This is Ledley King, as you say, scoring for the first time for ages. And the goal was coming, and this is O'Hara making it 2-0. And I was very disappointed. It wasn't a great game, John. It was the quality wasn't there. That was probably the two goals were the moments of real quality that we saw. And West Ham were disappointing. They're improving under Zola, but they can't score goals. They've had a couple of clean sheets recently. But if the other side score, they're not going to get anything out of the game. Now, they're in the relegation trap as well, so they've got to be careful. They'll have to buy a striker in the transfer window.
Big one tonight at Stamford Bridge. Chelsea have to win against their Romanian programme. Opponents about whom most people in this country know very little, actually.
No, they drew over there, didn't they? But things have changed at Chelsea. It's quite interesting. A fantastic away record, but Phil Scolari, to say he's under pressure is wrong, but there are signs that it's getting to him a little bit. You know, in the last home defeat by Arsenal, he blamed the referee and he blamed the linesman, which he hadn't done before. Now he keeps going on about, we must buy strikers, we must buy more players in the January transfer window. There was an incident last week where his comments were taken off the club's official website by the club because they saw it as a criticism of Roman Abramovich. Yes. Well, if they go out this evening, if they don't beat the Romanians, it'll cost Chelsea about £30 million by not going through to the last 16 of the Champions League.
Yeah, he's quoting the papers as saying it's not the end of the world if we go out. I don't think Abramovich should agree with that, would he?
No, nor would any of the fans, and nor would Chelsea board as well. But Scolari is hugely experienced, a World Cup winner, but I think what he's doing is coming to terms with the intensity and the pressure and the spotlight that these people are under in our Premier League, which, of course, is the most ferocious in the world when it comes to sort of having to get results.
Quick word about Sunderland. Several names in the ring. Big Sam Allardyce emerging as one of the favourites, along with Peter Reid. Who do you fancy?
I wouldn't go back to Peter Reid. I'm a great admirer of Peter Reid, but I always think it's wrong for a club to go back to a manager. Sam Allardyce, I would give it to. I mean, who would have thought that Sam would be out of a job for the whole of the year after being sacked by Newcastle in January? And I think it's just right for him. He used to play for them. He has an affiliation with the club, and I think he would be he would do a great job for them.
Okay, Brian, thanks very much indeed for being with us. Just a reminder that you can see the crucial Chelsea match live here on ITV tonight from 7:30.
Yep, you're watching the news hour here on GMTV this morning. The headlines: four people have been taken to hospital after a surprise gig by X Factor finalist JLS. The boy band were performing in South London ahead of Saturday night's final.
MPs are calling for tougher action on tax evaders who work for cash in hand. It's thought tax evasion costs the government more than £2 billion a year.
And displaying cigarettes and tobacco products in shops is expected to be banned to discourage people from smoking. Instead, they're now going to be moved under the counter. Now, our next guest this morning suffered the most horrific injuries imaginable after she was stabbed 20 times in an unprovoked attack. Amazingly, she lived, although she's been left with terrible physical and psychological scars. Well, yesterday, her attacker, Frenchman Christophe Bédard, was found guilty of attempted murder and jailed for a minimum of 12 years. Bédard, seen here on CCTV on the day of the attack, said he always carried a knife for protection. I'm pleased to say that Jessica joins me now, along with her parents, Jill Walmsley and Richard Knight. Welcome to all of you. Jessica, it must be very difficult for you to be here this morning, so thank you very much for coming in. How are you feeling today?
Fine. nothing really.
You're feeling okay. And what do you think of the sentence, 12 years your attack has been given? How do you feel about that?
Just, I knew it was going to come, really, so...
And Mum and Dad, what do you think about the sentence, 12 years?
Doesn't sound a lot on the face of it, really, does it? But the important thing, I think, for us was the that he was done on an attempted murder charge around the Section 18. This day and age, life doesn't mean life, so we kind of the judge did what he had to do. And
so just remind us again what happened to Jessica. What happened in the attack?
She was calling around for friends. It happened at 5:15 in the evening. Calling around to meet her friends, and she just happened to come across this guy who turns out, or it would appear, who's a very angry young man.
And it was a passerby that actually saved her life, wasn't it?
Yeah. A chap called Gareth, who you may have heard of.
He's a hero.
We know him quite well now.
So you've got to know him. How do you feel towards him? You must be incredibly grateful to him.
Yeah. He's very much at the top of the Christmas card list this year, that's for sure.
And Jessica, you've met Gareth. How did you feel when you first met him?
Nice bloke, really.
And how difficult has Jessica's recovery been since this? Because, I mean, it's a horrific ordeal, isn't it? It takes time to get back on track and not to, just to recover from the physical injuries that Jessica suffered, but also the emotional issues as well.
It's been a long... it's probably been 3 months from start to kind of finish as far as discharge is concerned. And the initial... I think the first 3 weeks were the really tough weeks because that was all about surviving. Mm-hmm. Once we knew she was going to survive it, it was just a case of how she's going to recover it and to what scale. And as you can see, she's done a fantastic job. But again, you mentioned Gareth. She wouldn't have had the chance if it wasn't for Gareth.
And interestingly, in this case, it was actually the attacker's mother who turned him into the police, wasn't it? How do you feel as a mother about that? It must take a very brave person to do that.
I must have done, but I mean... Now, if it hadn't been for her, the police would still have been looking for, you know, for the attacker. And, this, you know, there would have been a dangerous man on the streets. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, when it's happened, it sent, you know, obviously, a lot of parents worrying about the children and things like that. And, you know, if it hadn't have been for... He would have still been on the streets and, you know, he could have done it again.
Have you any idea why he behaved in this way?
No.
Why not?
I don't think we ever will. Obviously he's obviously got a few issues and, you know, he's obviously a very, very angry person, which we know we heard in court is, you know, a few incidents.
He said he always carried a knife, didn't he, for protection. How would you like to see knife laws changed?
There's basically, you know, if you've got a knife, why are you carrying a knife? There's no reasons why you should, you know, should be carrying a knife. And, you know, sort of like, if you have a knife, to hand it in, what's the point of carrying a knife with you? If you're not going to, you know, you're going to use it.
Yeah. He said it was for his protection, but you're saying there's no need to carry a knife at all. Thank you all for coming in and joining us this morning. We wish you all the best with your recovery,
Des. I think we're going to talk to that a bit later on at great length too, but thank you very much indeed for being here. Now then, if you've got neighbours who are elaborately decorating the outside of their house this week, you may be wondering how they pay the electricity bill for all those lights. Well, one neighbourhood in Somerset has banded together to come up with an eco-friendly answer. Richard Gaisford is down there and will explain all. He's at Burnham-on-Sea. Good morning to you, Richard.
Yes, good morning, John. In these dark and gloomy times, it's nice to have a bit of light in our lives, isn't it, to kind of brighten ourselves up. But with all these environmentalists telling us that these Christmas lights have a huge carbon footprint, they burn power and they also burn cash, you might think it could take the shine off of it. Well, not here in Trinity Close. As you look around, you can see pretty much every house is festooned with lights and they reckon it's not costing the earth. Let's have a chat with Nick Gardner here. Nick has spent days putting a lot of this together. Good morning to you, Nick. I mean, how many lights have gone in your house?
Roughly about 15,000.
And throughout the street?
I reckon it must be nearly 90,000, 100,000.
And you'd think that that means the electricity meter is just whirring away like a good one.
Not this year. I think we've all gone LED, so it costs nothing, hardly.
And the good thing about that is there's less maintenance, isn't there?
Well, hopefully, if one bulb blows, they all stay on, so that's brilliant.
And there is this community spirit here of everyone getting together. I know it started as a bit of a competition, but now you're all in.
No, we all do it for a laugh. It's just something, we do all the time, so it is good for the community.
Well, it is good, and a lot of people turn out to see it. You can take a look. Everyone has put lights up on their street, and as Nick said, the majority of them now are LED. And we look up the road here to the top of the close, and we see Chris Woodbury's house. And Chris, I mean, that's a lot of work you've put in there.
It takes about 3 or 4 days to get it all up together, yeah.
And you get people coming from all over to have a look.
Yeah,
and donating money for a very special cause. Now, can you tell us what that cause is?
Yeah, well, this year, all the money is going to a charity called Petal, which has been set up by my children in honour of my wife, who died recently this year of cancer.
And Christine loved the lights, didn't she?
Oh, yeah.
We met her a few years ago when we came down, and I guess it's a great way of raising money.
Yes, I can't think of anything better, because all walks of life, everybody, young and old, come down. And it's lovely to see the children's faces when they come down and see all these lights up. It's very fulfilling.
Well, Chris, thank you very much for getting up early. It is absolutely beautiful. The lights are on here between 4 o'clock in the afternoon and 10 o'clock every night. So if you are down this way in Somerset, pop along and have a look and put a bit of money in Chris's bucket.
Why not, Richard? It's all, as you say, in a very, very good cause. Thanks very much indeed.
Very festive, wasn't it?
It
puts our lights to shame, I think.
Well,
they're still nice.
Very spectacular.
They're still nice enough.
Spectacular, put it that way.
Anyway, still to come here on the News Hour, X Factor Fever comes to the News Hour, and if the thousands of people that turned out to see finalist JLS perform last night are anything to go by, a lot of people want them to win on Saturday. We're going to be talking to two of their biggest fans. JB's mum and auntie are on the sofa.
And as the high street takes a battering, we're talking about the pound shops that are bucking the trend, apparently.
The Girls Aloud Party, Saturday, 8:40, ITV1.
Good morning, ladies.
Good morning, Richard.
The digital switchover is happening now in the UK.
What do we need to do?
Inform everyone that they need cable, a satellite, broadband, or their existing aerial with a digital receiver to get it.
What happens if they don't?
This cannot happen. They will lose out on TV completely, so get to work. We don't have long.
Can you repeat that, Richard?
We don't have time, girls. Tell them to log on to gm.tv for more information.
Who might have thought one place could hold...
Everything I own becomes yours, your curiosity shop.
Both love and pain, lives bought and sold.
Let us run away. We shall be found.
Behind these doors are stories told. The Old Curiosity Shop, Sunday at 9, ITV1.
Morning, it's 6:23 here on the News Hour this morning. Now then, there is evidence that the high street is feeling the full force of the credit crunch. It's plain to see. Just look at all the sales, the discounts available at the moment. And there's more proof today of how shops are suffering. In new figures showing sales in November were down on last year. But while most retailers are facing their worst Christmas for decades, bargain stores are booming.
Bargain hunters are flocking in. This store's serving 30,000 customers a week, and the queues at the tills have been 12 deep at peak times.
So I've come in and got marvellous little bargains.
Many brands is much cheaper here than the other shops.
Things like shampoos, conditioners, household things. It's good value.
It's cheap, and when you ain't really got a lot of money, you can just come in and...
Other bargain stores like Pound Stretcher, Wilkinson Plus and 99p stores say they've also seen a rise in the number of shoppers in recent months. But for many, budget shopping for Christmas presents is just a step too far.
I'm not that cheap.
I'm joined now by consumer expert Jasmine Birtles. Jasmine, let's be honest, good deals or just cheap tat in these shops?
Well, it's a mix. And when you go into these shops, you do have to be a little bit careful. And I think much of it, frankly, is trial and error. But they are very good for, as you saw, you know, shampoos, household products, certain household products. There are some, I think, that are just cheap and they don't work that well. You know, there are certain things like cling film, it breaks, or washing up liquid, and it just doesn't last, you know. So you have to be a bit careful. But branded products, including, for example, health products, you know, cold remedies, that sort of thing, you can get those much cheaper there. And also, surprisingly, moisturisers, shampoos, conditioners. I know people who regularly get their moisturisers at the pound shop, and it's just as good.
What about Christmas presents? Because the savvy shoppers are apparently going to these stores where you can buy everything for a pound and buying their Christmas presents. Good idea? Can you get some good stuff in that respect?
Yeah, you can. You can. I mean, one of the things that I say, I talk about making your own hamper, for example, and I'd say pop down to the pound shop. You can get some really good beauty products, parcel them all up, and there you are, you have a nice present. They are also good for Christmas decorations. They're basic Christmas decorations.
But these decorations are going to fall apart, because I think buy cheap, buy twice, you know?
Sometimes, and I think this is the thing, there are times where you are going to be doing that. So if it's stuff that you want to use and throw away, then that's fine. But there are some things I would say, really, you have to be careful with the household products. And sometimes things are under a pound because they're small, you know. Mm-hmm. So you kind of have to be a little bit savvy and check with the other shops.
Do you think that the current economic climate is boosting them? Because a few mm-hmm. few months ago, maybe a year ago, there wasn't a huge amount you could get for under a pound that was any good, or a pound. But now, more things at a pound are actually a bargain.
Well, absolutely, and it's not just the pound shops. I mean, as we saw, Morrison's had very good results last week because they're on the value end. Asda's doing a fantastic job. You know, you can get all sorts of amazing bargains there. Tesco's has brought out its value range, which again is a bit of a mix. I think some elements are good, some aren't. And also open markets, you know, street markets are doing fantastically well. And quite a lot of the things I think you get in street markets, you get in pound shops as well, because I'm a devotee of street markets. I love them. And I see some of these bits, you know, like I say, you get cling film or washing powder or whatever. And you pick and choose. After a while, you get to know that actually that's not nearly as good as the branded stuff.
So while the pound shops are boosting, the rest of the high street's suffering, though?
Oh, totally is. I mean, as you say, there are amazing discounts out there. So much so that people are getting very confused, you know, and you're thinking, three for two, two for the price of one, should I be going for this? And I think the luxury ranges are really suffering. And I've been into luxury shops recently where they are saying three for the price of two, you know, come in and
we'll
massage
your temples. Gets a bit confusing, doesn't it? At least with a pound shop, you know everything is a pound.
Exactly.
You know where you are. It's easy to keep track of what you're spending.
Exactly.
Jasmine, thank you very much for joining us. Do you know what the most commonly asked question in the pound shop is, apparently?
Commonly asked question? How much is it?
Yeah. It's a pound.
Sorry, I didn't know I'd prempt your joke there, but it's pretty obvious, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Great. Well, what kind of bargains have you picked up in a pound store, or is it just cheap tats? Do let us know what you think by texting us on 67890. Text will cost you 25 pence, plus your standard network charge, and full terms can be found at gm.tv/terms.
Time now is 27 minutes past six. Let's catch up on the weather with Andrew, who's down in Kent.
GMTV Weather, sponsored by Nestlé Whole Grain Cereals. Keep your family healthy every day.
Hello there, I'm in Buellwater in Kent this morning, bringing you a little taste of Christmas. I have to say, it's beautiful here. You can see it's like a little Christmas village. Don't think I can quite fit in here. This is Santa's workshop. Have a little peek in here. This is where the kids can come and actually have a go at making toys themselves. We've got some elves having a go at the moment at helping Santa. What I can tell you is weather-wise, not particularly Christmassy here in Kent. You can see that quite clearly on the overnight radar picture and satellite image. We've seen an awful lot of rain moving its way across the country overnight. It's taking its time to clear away from the southeast, but it will do eventually. Also picking up some showers just across the far north and west of Scotland as well. Now for this morning, what you can see, as I say, is those showers falling across the north and west. Now that rain is falling on some very, very cold ground. So we're seeing problems with icy stretches on untreated roads across parts of Northern Ireland, the Highlands, Highlands of Scotland and also into the Northern Isles as well. So bear that in mind if you are going to be heading out. Elsewhere, well, we're seeing a clear, bright and frosty start, again, away from the southeast. Here in Kent, it's quite grey, it's quite drizzly, but that rain is already starting to ease away, and I think it will continue to do so as we move into this afternoon. So for this afternoon, I think most places seeing fine, dry and bright conditions, could continue to see those showers still pecking away at northern parts, but this time I think across northern eastern parts of Scotland and some filtering down into northeastern parts of England as well, so through Yorkshire and into East Anglia. Cold enough as well, we could well see some wintry showers over the hills. Temperature wise it's going to be pretty parky today, only getting up to around 4 or 5 degrees across most parts, only around 3 degrees at the moment here in the southeast. I think in the southwest where we could see a bit more cloud, temperatures maybe getting up to 6 or 7. Now, if you are looking ahead to the next couple of days or so, for tomorrow, pretty much more of the same, really. We're going to continue to see some very cold weather, again, perhaps even seeing some wintry showers on the hills. And I think this is how it's going to stay for the next couple of days or so. At least it makes you feel Christmassy. Easy summary.
For your local five-day weather update, visit our website, gm.tv.
Good morning. It's exactly 6:30 on Tuesday, the 9th of December. You're watching the News Hour here on GMTV. Still to come this morning, the tax evaders costing £2 billion a year. Why paying cash in hand is causing such a problem.
And we'll meet the young primary school teacher battling a brain tumour and trying to raise £150,000 for treatment in America.
And X Factor fever reaches an extreme as 5 teenage girls are injured trying to see finalist JLS. We'll talk to group member JB's mum and auntie.
Yes, that's our top story this morning. Fans of X Factor finalist JLS were caught in a crush last night when chaos broke out at a free concert. 4 people were taken to hospital with more treated at the venue in South London. The boys performing a surprise gig ahead of Saturday night's final. Aruj Dufrecia was there.
They'd come for a night to remember, but for all the wrong reasons, it was a night they'd never forget. When 5,000 fans turned up for just 200 free tickets, the crowd surged, crushing some against the barrier.
Everyone just pushed and the barriers broke and the police just came out of nowhere and just tried to stop everyone.
People pushing against barriers, had to be bouncers, had to take the kids out and everything.
People getting punched in the face, people getting kicked, people on the floor, people just trodden all over them.
5 people were injured and 4 taken to hospital, 1 with a suspected fracture. JLS say they never expected to see so many fans.
I don't think everyone expected the numbers that have come down today, you know. Obviously, we've heard that things have happened and, you know, obviously it's unfortunate. But, you know, we're here
to speedy recovery, of course.
But organisers claim they did everything to control the crowds.
You get crushes that happen in all sorts of walks of life. The mere fact that the audience, which is all young girls, pushed forward, so there's going to be a crush when you've got barriers in front. We've done our best, and we believe done it reasonably well, to cope with the current problem.
Before playing the gig, JLS said hello to fans who didn't get in, giving the police another small headache. This time, no one was hurt.
Yes, that report from Aruj Dufrecia. We hope to talk to one of the boys' mums and his auntie a little bit later on.
Yep. Let's get this morning's other stories now from Tiffany.
Thank you. Good morning. MPs are this morning calling for tougher action on tax evaders who work for cash-in-hand payment. The Public Accounts Committee want tougher penalties to ensure self-employed professionals like builders, decorators, cleaners and buy-to-let landlords pay their fair share in income tax. It's thought tax evasion costs the government more than £2 billion a year, leaving the rest of us to make up the shortfall. Displaying cigarettes and tobacco products in shops is expected to be banned as part of a plan to cut down on the number of people who smoke. Instead, they'll be moved under the counter and out of sight, in what's hoped will discourage children from taking up the habit and help those who've already quit. But critics are trying to block the plan, saying corner shops and news agents could lose out. 3 people have been confirmed dead after an American fighter jet crash-landed in San Diego. 2 homes were destroyed when the plane came down just 2 miles from its base in California. The pilot, thought to be on a solo training exercise, safely ejected from the aircraft, but is thought to have sustained injuries. The government's economic rescue package seemed to have been given the public seal of approval this morning, with a new poll suggesting people trust Gordon Brown more than David Cameron when it comes to leading the country through recession. The populist poll shows Labour's rating on the economy has jumped 6 points since the pre-budget report, but the Conservatives still hold a 4-point lead overall. There's more bad news for retailers this morning, with November's sales figures showing a drop of 0.4% on last year. It's the second month in a row that like-for-like sales have fallen. The British Retail Consortium said the figures prove the high street's facing a nerve-wracking Christmas. The alleged mastermind of the 9/11 terrorist attacks and his four co-defendants have told a pre-trial hearing at Guantanamo Bay they intend to plead guilty. Khalid Sheikh Mohammed said they had decided to abandon efforts to defend themselves on the day Barack Obama was elected. It means they could now face execution. There are signs this morning that the housing market could be picking up. The number of house hunters rose for the first time in 2 years last month. The Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors claims the recent interest rate cuts are tempting potential buyers back onto the market. But despite the renewed interest, the number of homes sold still slumped to a record low. It may be the stuff of old wives' tales, but it seems a nice hot drink really can help cure the common cold. Researchers at Cardiff University found sipping a hot mug of fruit cordial gave significant and sustained relief from cold and flu symptoms like a runny nose, sore throat and tiredness. And on the website this morning, why the credit crunch is forcing many families to cut back on food this Christmas. Our motorists would rather save a few pounds than save the environment. And we've an exclusive first look at the trailer for Disney's upcoming 3D animation adventure Bolt. All that and more at gm.tv. And finally, there's already talk of an Oscar nomination for Brad Pitt in his latest role. He was joined by Angelina Jolie and his co-star Kate Blanchett on the red carpet in Los Angeles for the premiere of the highly anticipated film The Curious Case of Benjamin Button. Carla Romano was there.
The sexiest man alive walking down the red carpet for the premiere of his latest movie, The Curious Case of Benjamin Button. With co-star Kate Blanchett and other stars like J-Lo exciting the crowds, there was only one woman stealing the limelight, and it was shining on Angelina Jolie, who also had the very important job of looking after Brad's parents, who came along for support. The movie centres around a man who is ageing in reverse, and it's one of the most hotly anticipated films of the year.
E7.
And we really took it more as two individuals who cross at different times, and at one point it makes sense for them to come together, but that must end too at some point.
The Curious Case of Benjamin Button isn't the only big movie this Christmas. Brad Pitt competes with ex-wife Jennifer Aniston's Marley and Me, which is also out on Christmas Day. Although it could be a day of the battle of the exes at the box office, at home, Brad and Angelina will have more than enough to think about on Christmas Day. Their six children.
The time is now 6:36. Now here's what's happening where you are.
Thanks, Tiffany. Good morning. Here are the main stories in the Northwest. The parents of a five-year-old boy from Saddleworth who suffers from a rare genetic disorder are trying to raise awareness about the condition. Edward Aykroyd suffers from the muscle-wasting disease Duchenne muscular dystrophy, of which there is no cure. They're launching a music single in the hope it will raise money for the charity Action Duchenne.
I hope that it will achieve awareness. It will raise the profile of Duchenne as a condition. And it will raise money for Action Duchenne to be able to pump into the research, which right now is extremely promising.
An elderly man has died after being hit by a van while crossing a road in Lancashire. It's happened on the A680 in Accrington near to Hollins Lane, closing the route for 4 hours. The driver of the van has been arrested on suspicion of causing death by dangerous driving. A Merseyside woman who claims she was tricked into buying crossbreed dogs by a Welsh puppy farmer is warning others not to be caught out this Christmas. Margaret Howard bought three Pomeranian dogs from Trevor Jones. Believing them to be pedigrees, she was later told by her vet they were in fact crossbreeds. She took Jones's company to court and won, but was unable to get her money back.
He'll tell you anything to make you buy these dogs. Then when something goes wrong...
He doesn't want to know.
There's no Mr. Nice Jones anymore. It's Nasty Mr. Jones.
Sporting in the Champions League, Liverpool are gearing up for their tie against Dutch side PSV Eindhoven. Robbie Keane is expected to be handed the task of leading the attack. It comes after the out-of-form striker was left on the bench during Saturday's fixture against Blackburn. The Reds are already through to the last 16 of the competition. In other football news, and Stockport take on Gillingham, Droylsden are up against Chesterfield and Tranmere host Peterborough in the second round of the FA Cup this evening. Now to John for a look at the weather forecast.
GMTV weather is brought to you by new Olbus menthol lozenges. Breathe easy, whatever the weather.
Good morning. It's a bright enough day for most of us. There might be a little bit of fog first thing up the A6, up the M6, and there'll be a shower or two over the Wirral, North Wales, the Isle of Man. Dry for many though, but top temperatures, well, 5 Celsius in Failsworth and Fulwood. It's going to feel chilly in that northwesterly wind.
That's the news for the northwest this morning. I'm back in half an hour's time, but now back to Priya and John.
Welcome back. 21 minutes to 7 is the time. Let's take a look at the morning papers. The FT leads on the news that more corporate pension funds are in big trouble, and so might the government's lifeboat scheme be too, if they all claim on it. The great credit card scandal is a splash in the Independent, saying companies are defying ministers by increasing charges despite the plunging interest rates. Tell us if that's happened to you, by the way. Brown's recovery gathers pace with new poll boosts. That's a poll saying that most people in the country prefer Mr. Brown, Mr. Darling, to lead us through the recession as opposed to their opponents. The Daily Telegraph has a story about jobless middle-class people getting study cash, again, to help them through the recession, while The Guardian concentrates on a piece saying that supplies are having to be taken, or may have to be taken, via Belarus and the Ukraine, that's right, Belarus and the Ukraine, to get to our lads and lasses in Afghanistan.
Quick look at the front of the tabloids this morning. The Sun leads with them at last. Sharon Shoesmith, who is head of children's services at Haringey, has now been sacked without a payoff. Front of the Daily Mail, home packs, a new fiasco. Apparently now you're going to have a home pack the moment your house goes on sale, not 28 days later, which was the leeway that was given before. Daily Express, a tank of petrol now £18 cheaper than it was in the summer thanks to plummeting pump prices. Always good news. And front of the Daily Mirror, ex-fracas. That's the story that we've been telling you about in the news. Several fans have been injured at a JLS gig, and we're going to be talking to JLS family members later on.
Now then, have you ever paid someone in cash, perhaps a builder or a window cleaner? Chances are that you have, and according to a group of MPs, it's costing the country, well, it could be costing the country anyway, £2 billion a year in lost tax. Public Accounts Committee says it wants us to be more aware of the serious consequences of tax evasion. So how widespread a problem is it?
I have paid for our bathroom to be redone cash in hand.
We had a break-in at our house and we had a window replaced and we paid cash in hand for that.
It's just what you do, isn't it? It's automatic. You ring somebody up, you come to an arrangement and just cash passes hands, and it's up to them what they then declare, isn't it?
I paid him in cash, not so that he could avoid tax, but because had I given him a cheque, the bank would have charged him for paying it in.
You're not really supposed to do it. But if you just give them a bit of casual money now and again, you know, so sue me.
Well, some very, very honest interviewees there. Joined now by Labour MP Nigel Griffiths, who's on the Public Accounts Committee, which looked into this problem. That's the problem, isn't it? I mean, everyone does it.
Well, it is a problem. I used to be consumer minister and I warned people that, you know, if you pay peanuts, you get monkeys and you get very poor jobs. And really, if you've got somebody coming into your house and doing a repair, you want that repair to last. And that's why you should really go through reputable people, reputable firms. And there are a lot of small business people, one man, one woman outfits that do great jobs and, of course, put everything through the books.
And do it quite legitimately. Nevertheless, there are others who say, well, do you want to do this cash or do you want to do a check? I've all done it. I mean, I've done it. I can't remember when, funnily enough, but I have done it. Have you done it?
Well, I wouldn't confess to such a thing on here,
no.
Certainly. But what the report says...
You're not denying it.
What the report says is that 120,000 people picked up the phone and shopped some of these people, yeah, and that the government and the Inland Revenue have been able to recoup large sums of money, about £145 million last year, from people who failed to declare tax or VAT.
But most people get away with it, don't they? Let's be honest about this. And very, very few, a tiny, tiny percentage are ever prosecuted.
The report does show it's a small proportion, but it's an increasing proportion. And if you look at Britain's record as against the EU, we've squeezed it down to about 2% of evasion as against an average of 5% across the 27 countries and up to 18% in some countries. So the Inland Revenue are giving out a clear message, as the report said, and that is we're onto this and we're squeezing people.
OK, but wouldn't a simpler answer be just to reduce VAT? Because that's what gets everybody in there. I mean, endless people come up to you and say, well, do you want to pay the VAT or shall we do it cash? You
know? Well, we'll see.
I mean, if VAT has come down to 15%, it may help a little bit, but, you know, even so, if that was down to 5, as they brought it down apparently in the Isle of Man with great results, the Treasury got far more money in the Isle of Man. Can we follow their lead to some extent?
Well, the Isle of Man's got its own problems, if I might say, on banking and on other issues. And of course we can follow a lead and reduce tax. If you reduce tax, you don't get any evasion at all. But of course then you can't pay for our health service and our other essential public services.
And this £2 billion is one heck of a lot of money. It's a heck of a lot of motorways, hospitals, schools or whatever.
Oh no, it's a lot of money. Of course it's not just £2 billion on VAT. And that's the other thing. If you take it down off VAT and let's say put it on income tax, you've got to bear down on those who are trying to dodge income tax. And again, I think £400 million was recouped last year from people who were trying to dodge that.
But be honest, Nigel, you're talking about changing an entire culture in this country, aren't you? I mean, changing a mindset.
No, listen, I don't think most people do dodge VAT and do dodge tax in this country. I think there are some countries in Europe and elsewhere where that's a bit more of the culture. But actually, I think people are a lot more straightforward in this country and do pay their taxes generally.
OK, well, let us know what our viewers think. Thanks very much indeed for being with us. Are you part of a cash-in-hand culture, or do you insist on doing it by the book? Let us know what you think by texting us 67890. Text costs 25p, plus your standard network charge. Full terms can be found at gm.tv/terms.
You're watching the news hour here on GMTV. This morning's headlines. 4 people have been taken to hospital after a stampede at a gig held by X Factor finalist JLS. The band were performing in South London ahead of Saturday night's final.
Displaying cigarettes and tobacco products in shops is expected to be banned in an attempt to discourage people from smoking. Instead, they'll be moved under the counter.
And 3 people have been confirmed dead after an American fighter jet crash-landed on a training exercise in San Diego. Now then, when a young primary school teacher from Staines discovered she had a cancerous brain tumour, she knew she'd have to undergo extensive treatment. But when Melissa Huggins' pupils discovered that she'd have to go to America for an expensive form of therapy, they got to work to help out. We were contacted by 10-year-old Ruby Lyde from Ashford in Middlesex.
There's a lovely teacher at my school called Miss Huggins who is battling a brain tumour for the second time and she is only 27. She is amazing as even though she is ill, someday she still comes in to teach her 4- and 5-year-old pupils. This time is worse and the treatment to save her is only available in America.
We're joined now by Ruby's teacher, Melissa Huggins, and her fiancé, James. Morning. Thank you so much for coming in this morning.
Thank you.
What a lovely email we had from Ruby. She obviously, along with the other classmates, thinks the world of you.
Absolutely. I mean, I wasn't told until yesterday that actually she contacted GMTV, and it was just absolutely amazing. They've been fantastic at school, and all the children are just really lovely and keep me going, really.
Probably boosts your spirits, doesn't it? Well, the reason she contacted us is because she wants to try and help you raise money for your treatment in America. So how much money do you need?
$190,000 US.
Well, which is, what, about £150,000?
About that.
Isn't it? Around about that. So how's the money going to be used? Is it just for the treatment?
It's for proton therapy.
And what is that? Tell us about that.
Basically, it's a form of radiotherapy, but it's a lot more direct. So rather when with normal radiotherapy, that would attack my cells and nerves around my brainstem and my spine. Proton therapy actually shapes your tumour and just attacks that.
So it's much more specific?
Yes. Okay. So the damage that I would have from normal radiotherapy, it wouldn't happen with proton therapy. And because they can give you a higher dose, it would obviously kill the tumour more than normal radiotherapy.
And why are you having to go to America for this treatment?
Because there isn't a proton therapy machine in England. Well, there is one up north, but it's only for eye cancer. It's not strong enough for brain tumours.
OK. And your fiancé, James, is with you this morning. This is the second time that Melissa's been ill, isn't it, with a brain tumour. How do you kind of keep your strength and her strength?
I don't know. We just sort of try and live life as normal as possible, really. Go to work, go on holidays, just be normal.
We always said from the onset that we would keep normal and keep going and, you know, just try and raise awareness and not give in to anything. And
And I suppose that just keeps you positive, doesn't it? Which keeps you, you ticking along. And you're organising, you and your friends and family, you're organising loads of events, aren't you, to raise money. What kind of stuff are you doing and how's that going?
We had an event on Saturday at like a bar nightclub in Weybridge, which all my friends had arranged for us, and we raised nearly £3,000 on Saturday. We've got an auction this Saturday and someone's doing a 12-hour run in Staines at Virgin Active Gym. And some raffles on Christmas Eve and lots of skydives.
So you've got lots going on then. And I understand you plan to get married next year as well.
We were.
You were.
Postponed at the minute.
Yeah, we postponed it till 2010.
Okie dokie. Well, I can't believe as well, it's quite remarkable that you're actually going into school still and teaching. Is that one thing that kind of keeps you positive?
Absolutely. The children are just fantastic and they have, you know, they don't really understand, so they keep me very normal and keep me smiling, and we're practicing for our Christmas play at the moment, which is brilliant.
How's it for you going through this?
It's quite hard, but I think the fundraising's really sort of taken our mind off things, you know.
We're trying to plough our emotions into positive energies. You can't sit back and think, why me, poor me, or anything like that. I refuse to be like that. I just think...
Just got to get the money and get her better.
Absolutely, and try and raise awareness for this proton therapy and try and get a machine here.
Sure, all of our viewers wish you every success. Thank you very much for coming in.
Thanks
to your people.
Absolutely. Thank you, Ruby.
She deserves a gold star for that.
Absolutely.
And lots more information on Melissa's Fighting Fund on our website, gm.tv.
Yeah. Well, coming up later on in the programme, Andrew's been talking to Scarlett Johansson and Samuel L. Jackson about their new film, The Spirit.
Yes, and this apparently is the extent of the hysteria that X Factor finalists JLS are causing. Five teenage girls were injured at a free concert last night. We'll be talking to a couple of JLS's biggest fans, a mum and an auntie. That's coming up in just a couple of ticks.
Kate Winslet, tomorrow.
Getting off cigarettes on your own is hard. You're up to four times more likely to quit with NHS support. And you're more likely to succeed if you quit in January than at any other time. So if you're planning to get off cigarettes in the new year, call us now for your free DVD on how to quit. Call 0800 169 1697 now or visit www.nhs.uk/smokefree. Get off cigarettes with NHS support.
For back pain, now there's something that's as effective as taking 6 ibuprofen tablets. One Thermacare heat wrap can relieve your pain throughout the whole day, so you can get on with your day. Thermacare heat wraps, like taking a holiday from your back pain.
There are loads of spot treatments. I've tried some of them, but then I found Freedom. It's different from the rest. Freedom is the only one with an anti-inflammatory. It doesn't just help my red spots fade away. Even better, it helps keep them away too. It works for me. Nothing treats spots like Freedom. Now there's even more Freedom for you. New Freedom Facial Cleanser. Part of your expert skincare range from Freedom. Expert skincare for spot-prone skin.
Moonpig! I say, old man, do you know where I can find a totally spiffing greetings card?
Oh, yes. Moonpig offers a mind-boggling choice of cards.
Who did you say?
Moonpig!
You can even upload a photo to become part of the design, then personalise any Moonpig card by changing the name, the text and the greeting. If you order by 2 p.m, your card will be sent out the same day by first-class post. Add some Moonpig magic to a special occasion.
Moonpig.com.
Nasty catarrh clogging your nose or throat? Give it something you can feel working. Cavonia! Catarrh medicine with clout. Part of the Cavonia range.
Hair colour that shimmers full of golden tones gives me a healthy looking glow.
So indulge in Casting Creme Gloss from L'Oréal Paris.
Super glossy. My colour never looked so shimmery. All this and no ammonia. It's what I've been waiting for.
Now introducing new glossy blacks from Casting Creme Gloss. Dark chocolate, ebony black and black cherry.
When he opened Inkheart...
Once upon a time, there was a traveling juggler.
The story came to life.
Your voice brought him out of the book.
Now, the adventure is so real, it will jump off the page.
Explore rich Swiss chocolat and discover honey and almond nougat hidden within. Lose yourself in the Toblerone Triangle.
Some gifts can bring out the best in a person. This Christmas, give the gift of Gillette's best shave, Gillette Fusion Power.
A full range of gift sets available in-store now.
Samsung, Sony, Philips, save up to 40% on selected branded electricals. This week's offer all wrapped up at littlewoodsdirect.com.
Do you know who's on GMTV?
Enrique!
Do you know what it feels like loving someone? Enrique Iglesias, tomorrow on GMTV.
Welcome back. 6 minutes to seven is the time. With just a few days to go until the final X Factor fever is reaching new levels. Five teenage girls were injured last night after thousands of fans turned up at a free performance by the finalist JLS. They go up against Owen Quigg and Alexander Burke on Saturday. But who will get your vote? Well, that's what we're finding out this week. Joined now by two of JLS's biggest fans. That's group member JBS's mum, Cynthia. There she is, and her aunt, Annie's auntie, Millicent. Thank you very much indeed for getting up to talk
to us.
Let's talk first of all about last night. You were there.
Yes.
How would you describe those events?
It was quite hectic.
It was pandemonium. The fans was out there from about 7 o'clock in the morning, queuing up for tickets just to see JLS.
Well, that's remarkable. Good news to the band. But I'm told they'd only expect a few hundred, and about 5,000 turn up. That was a root of the problem, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think a lot more people turned up than were actually expected.
Yeah.
So then that created an issue in terms of crowd control. So.
Right. So when you say an issue in terms of crowd control, you're in the middle of it. Describe what you saw and heard.
It was very exciting, a lot of screaming girls all trying to get in, and then obviously there were too many for the venue because it only holds 1,500, so that caused them to be very anxious about not potentially seeing the boys. So they got very excited. And then the boys weren't able to come through, so that made it even worse because they had to wait
so
to see them.
Forward, was it?
Yes, yeah. Most definitely a search.
Were some people crushed?
Some people were crushed. Some were injured. We had a couple of girls fainting. There weren't enough security.
And one of them talked about fights between girls as well that were taking place. We had one interviewee earlier on our bulletin piece saying that there were fights. Did you see that?
No.
I didn't witness any fighting, none at all.
Okay.
But to be fair, I think that they weren't expecting so many people to turn up. So, in fact, the security was adequate for the number that they thought were going to be there, but obviously it transpired there were an awful lot more. So.
Okay. Anyway,
hence
fortunately, it
problem.
Wasn't too bad. There's only five people injured, and the injuries were not by any measure serious. Let's talk about the lads. I mean, you must be delighted, mustn't you?
Well, they're absolutely delighted to be in the final, and it's very exciting to see them at this stage of the competition. I'm really looking forward to that
you
on
think
Saturday.
They're going to win?
Yes.
Yes.
Well, you've got to say that,
yes.
Of course, we're a bit biased.
But I didn't realize, you just told me before I came out, your lad was studying theology before.
He's a student at KCL in London, and he's been studying theology for 2 years. This is technically his third year and final year, which he's suspended from university.
So, okay, well, whatever happens to them, there he is, studying, as you said, that whatever happens to them, we wish them well, as we'll wish all the finalists well, of course. We've got to be impartial in these matters. Thanks very much, Steve, for coming in to talk to us. I'm glad you survived last night.
Thank you.
Well, that's all from the news. Now, Fiona and Andrew are here next, and they'll be talking to Money Man Martin Lewis about your rights at Christmas.
But before all that, Andrea's getting festive down in Kent with the weather.
GMTV Weather, sponsored by Nestlé Whole Grain Cereals. Keep your family healthy every day.
Hello there. Now, we're bringing you the Christmas experience from Bluewater in Kent this morning. If I look a slightly funny colour, I'm afraid our light is just broken, so I'm not naturally this blue or naturally this cold, but we thought we'd still show you these lovely pictures. Look, these people have got up extra early just to skate around in the background for us here in Kent. Now, It's Christmassy here, but is it Christmassy where you are? Let's take a look on the overnight satellite picture. And what you can see is we've got a large area of cloud that's just over the southeast. Now, that's bringing a very, very grey and quite a wet start to the day for Kent. Clearing away all the time, though. In between, we have clearer skies and we've got showers across the far north. For this morning, what that does mean is we are seeing some showers, some of them turning quite wintry and falling over very, very cold ground across parts of Northern Ireland. That's counted down. Antrim, also across the Highlands of Scotland and up across the Northern Isles. We have problems with ice on untreated roads here. For this afternoon, I think what we will see is most skies clearing. So even the rain here in Kent, the cloud, that will clear away. Most places seeing a beautiful, bright, sunny, if crisp afternoon. The showers continuing in the north, but I think they will be moving across to the northeast rather than the northwest. So that's northeastern parts of Scotland, some even filtering into northeastern England, so from Yorkshire down into East Anglia. But elsewhere, I think it's going to be lovely. It is going to be cold, though, temperature-wise, only up to 4 or 5 degrees in most places, maybe a touch higher, but we hang on to some cloud across parts of the south and west. Now, if you're looking ahead to the next couple of days or so, it is more of the same. It's going to remain chilly for the next couple of days, also fairly breezy, generally dry and bright with frosty starts in the morning, and again, a continuation of some showers, which could well turn quite wintry again over the hills. I think we have to wait until the end of the week before we start to see more in the way of unsettled weather, and with that I mean more in the way of rain out to the west. Thank you for bearing with me with my blue face. I'll see you again in around half an hour or so. Lucy Summary.
Get a 5-day weather update for your postcode on our website, gm.tv.